it. So let me start. So I'm Julie from the Sephardic Community Center and the Women's Center, the Culture Club. We're so excited to have Ariana Neumann, the author of the book with us. Sorry for a second. When Time Stopped. I got a little nervous for a second. Monique Haddad is my chairperson. Alice Chair will be moderating the program today. And we're doing it in conjunction with the SCA, which is another community organization. And Monique, you want to say anything?
So we just want to say what the Sephardic Community Center does and the SCA. The center's been offering so many programs to the community without charge the past couple of months during this virus. And we just want to say thank you for all that's been joining us and coming to hear all our speakers and our lectures and all our Zoom programs. God willing, from here on in, we're going to start hopefully doing some more things in person, maybe on Fortune's side. Really, Ariana, we really appreciate you joining us today. I know it's late by you in London, and we're so excited to hear from you and hear your story and your journey. And really, thank you. The SCA is amazing. They came and joined us today on this program. We get both joint parties, always adds to much more people and much more viewing. And anything else?
No, so let's Ariana. This is Ariana Neumann, and she wrote When Time Stopped, and she's going to give us a brief history of how she came about to write that book. So go ahead, Ariana. Welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Did we say that we're not having anybody speak? We're just going to have Alice.
Ariana will be on you.
Sorry, Ariana. Alice Chi will be moderating. And if you have any questions, it's going to be hard for Ariana and Alice to be moderating if too many people speak. Yeah. We're just going to have Alice speak. If you have any questions, please put it on the chat. And Alice will ask the questions. And just FYI, so that we don't have people interrupting, because it's going to be very interesting. Sorry, thank you.
I have a quick question. Am I unmuted? I'm unmuted, right? Did you guys get some freezing just now, or is that my internet connection, which is suddenly going unstable? All right, maybe what I'll do is I'm going to move into the next room, if that's okay. I'll put my...
Sometimes if you work from your phone, it's better. You get better service. If the Wi-Fi is not so good.
Usually I get good service here. I'm not sure, but everything was breaking up just now, and I don't want that to be happening while we're doing the interview. So I'm just going to stop my video for a minute while I walk into the next room. Okay, guys, so it doesn't distract you.
Great.
Okay.
You let me know when you want me to start. Yeah? Okay.
Yes, well, go ahead.
Hello from London, England, where I live, where it's 5:05 and it's surprisingly gray. It's a huge honor to be here and to talk to all of you. And I'm incredibly grateful to you all for reading my memoir. One, because it's a very personal thing. It's my first book, and I'm just hugely grateful that it's been in your hands. So thank you. It's really a huge honor and a privilege to be here. So I assume you've read the book, so I'm not going to talk a lot about the book, but I'm very happy to answer any questions that you have whatsoever. But I thought I would tell you a little bit about my journey and about how I came to write the book, because that's not really in the book. So I thought I should start by telling you that this was never meant to be a book. I always wanted to write as a little girl. I wanted to write and I wanted to be a detective. But this didn't start off as a book. It really started off as a personal journey. As you know, my father was very, very mysterious. I was fascinated by him as a child. Ironically, I'm still fascinated by him as an adult. But it was really a journey to discover my roots, to find where I came from, because I never quite felt like I belonged anywhere. And I certainly didn't feel like I belonged in this beautiful tropical country filled with light and color, where everyone around me seemed to be Catholic. And I couldn't quite explain why I didn't feel like I belonged. And I tried really hard to belong, but I really didn't. So I always felt a little disjointed all my life. And I always knew that there was a mystery to my father. So it wasn't a surprise that he was hiding something. I knew he was hiding something. I just didn't know the magnitude of what he was hiding. And as you know, I had little clues. So I had the ID card, and I thought, I don't usually do this, but I thought I would show you the box. So this is the actual box that I found when I was a child detective. And it's just a very boring box file. And I'm not going to show you everything that's in it because you'd be very bored. But I thought I would show you, sorry, I have this, and I don't usually pull these things out, but they're all in acid-free paper because obviously I want to preserve them. But you can see here, that's my father's ID card. So it's a tiny little card. It's meant, it was meant to be carried around like that. And this is what I found as a child detective. And I had absolutely no doubt that that was my father. And I don't know if you can see it. I don't know if it's sort of close enough, but it was pretty terrifying. So as a child to find that, it's just one of those moments. I'm sure you all go back and you have these moments in your childhood that you remember distinctly. And most of mine have something to do with photographs. So when I have a photograph of a birthday party, I tend to remember it better than when I don't. And this is one of those few moments where I have no photographs whatsoever, which I remember vividly finding this card. So that obviously set me off on the journey. And as I'm sure you know, if you have ever been around or grown up with someone that's traumatized, when you love someone that's had a trauma, you learn to not ask questions. You learn to not upset them. And their feelings and their well-being becomes more important, really, than your curiosity, as it were. So I never really asked too many questions. And it wasn't until 2001 when my father died. So he died September 9th, 2001. His funeral was September 11th. So as if there wasn't enough going on that day and all the horrors, my father was cremated that day. And I was living here in London, and I couldn't go back to Caracas because I was very, very pregnant. And, well, very pregnant, but I couldn't travel. And it wasn't until a few months later that I went back and got this box again. And this time the box looked a little bit like it did now. So when I was a child, the box had very few papers and it was sort of closed shut. Now I had this box and it was absolutely crammed with letters, with all sorts of things that I couldn't piece together. And I was pretty terrified. I mean, I was very, that's not true. I was very grateful when I found the box. And I took it back to London with me, and I carried it with me on the plane, and I knew it was hugely important. But I was terrified about what I was going to find. I honestly didn't know what my father had done to survive. And I didn't really delve into it until much later. But I did actually know, sorry, I know that I had to sort of find, I knew that I had to solve the mystery, and I knew I had to find the courage from somewhere. And I started asking questions. And at that stage, my Lothar's widow, so Vera, was still alive. And I have two cousins who are about 25 years older than me, and they knew a little bit more than me, but I didn't grow up with them. So they were older. They lived in one of them lived in England. So when I was here, I became quite close to her, and I started asking her questions. And eventually in around 2010 or 11, her mother Vera, so Lothar's wife, sent me all the letters from my grandparents. And I had those translated. It took a long time to find someone to translate them, because you can't just take anyone from the Czech Republic and ask them to do this. They have to be very patient. They have to decipher the handwriting. They needed to speak German. They needed to speak Czech. They needed actually to understand the language of the times, because as I'm sure, well, as is obvious actually from the pandemic, our language changes, right? We now are all we're all isolating and quarantining, and in England we have bubbles of people that you can see. So, you know, language changes as the times change, and the language of 1942 in Czechoslovakia has nothing to do with the language of 2012 in the Czech Republic. So I eventually found a lovely historian who is also a filmmaker, who was an expert in the Holocaust, and who was Czech. And he went to Brandeis in America, so he also spoke perfect English, and he translated them for me. And then I started, little by little, I started reading them. And again, I was absolutely terrified that they were just going to be filled with darkness. And I saw someone had a little lovely baby somewhere in their camera, just there. I forget who it was. And, you know, as you're having children, at least I felt very vulnerable when my kids were little. And I felt like I had to be very positive for them and very hopeful. And, you know, it really is actually the most optimistic act we do, right? We bring children, we bring people that we love into this world. So I didn't feel I could marry the two. I didn't feel I could, you know, be positive and paint with my kids and take them to the playground and then, you know, come home and read some letters of my grandparents when they were interned in Theresienstadt. So it took me a little while, and I would, you know, whenever they were at school, I would read a little bit. And slowly I started to realize actually that these letters weren't as dark as I imagined them. Actually, my grandmother's particularly were filled with the most incredible light and joy. And she was a really positive person, and that helped me enormously. So by now we're in sort of 2012-13, and actually because I knew I had to do this, and it's sort of preparation. And again, I felt not only vulnerable when I had children, I also felt like my brain had turned a little bit to sort of mush. So I did a master's in psychology of religion, which was an odd master's to do, really. And I realize now it was all sort of falling together so that I could tell the story, I think. But at the time I didn't know that, but I did psychology of religion because I was interested. And again, I was brought up in quite a Catholic country, and my mother's family is quite Catholic. My own family weren't religious at all, as evidenced by the weird art in my father's house, and we didn't go to church or anything like that. But religion, and I knew obviously by 2012 that my father was Jewish, and I felt very angry that he hadn't shared his Jewish heritage with me. So it was very useful to do this master's and to understand actually what it is that, well, how helpful religion is as in our daily life. And again, what it is that we look for in a religion, and again, how traumatized my father was, and why he shunned religion and indeed his heritage. So I then started tracing people probably in 2014. I found the first ones, and I found Stenka. And as I found, there were three people that I thought were really inspiring that had nothing, that weren't members of my family. One was Stenka, and the other one was Stenek, my father's best friend, and the other one was Mr. Novak. And I was really taken by these people who were incredibly generous and brave. And, you know, my family didn't have a choice. They either chose to follow the rules and they would be deported and eventually ended up where in Auschwitz or wherever they ended up. Or they could try to rebel. And I guess my father tries to rebel, and he is very lucky that his crazy punt works. But these other people, their life wasn't at risk. So the fact that they turned around and helped my family just seemed so absolutely just beautiful and courageous. And, you know, one of them, when I met them, said we were just doing the right thing. But the truth is that most people in between the 30s and 40s didn't do the right thing. And they didn't stand up for what they knew, obviously, was right. So to find these people that did, to me, was incredibly heartening. And I wanted to tell their stories. And as I sort of pieced it all together, I realized actually that I had this enormous family and you know, they're mine, obviously. But I think they're really quite beautiful, and I think the stories are stunning. And I figured if I didn't tell their stories, then no one else would. And one of my first cousins, the first cousins that I traced, was my cousin Victor in San Diego, and he had obviously never heard of me, but he had never heard of. I mean, he knew his grandfather Victor, and his uncle Richard, but he had vaguely heard that there was a bit of the family in Venezuela, but he didn't know any of the stories. He didn't even know he was Jewish either. So I thought it was important to tell stories. And I now, having done a lot of reading around Judaism, I understand how important it is for everyone, or for all us all, to tell our stories. And that's how we learn, and that's how we ensure that things don't happen again. So it really wasn't until 2017 that this became a book. And in 2014-15, I promised my cousin Victor and another cousin, Jana, who was in Paris, and my cousin Dana in the Czech Republic, and indeed some other people that I traced, so engineer Langer's daughter who lives in Australia, that I would put all the stories that I had amassed in a book. So it became a book then in about 2015, and I haven't written that book yet, because that book is about 2,000 pages, and it's just filled with stories of, you know, the 35 members of my family that were alive then. And I don't think Scribner will want to publish it, because they already thought I had too many characters. And I think most people wouldn't want to read it. But I owe that to my family. So I have all the stories. I just need to sort of collate them all into one book. So that's still going to happen. And it became a book. Actually, I don't think I've ever really told a story before. It became a book in 2017 because I was at JFK Airport, and it was 6 a.m. and we were about to board a flight, my family and I, to London. And my husband is really good with faces. And he said, look, over there, that's Simon Sharma. And I don't know if you know who Simon Sharma is, but he's a historian. He teaches at Columbia University. He's very well known in the UK, and he's done lots of books. He's done History of the Jews, but Google him. And if you haven't read his stuff, he's really remarkable. It's Sharma, S-C-H-A-M-A. And he's quite famous here because he does a lot of programs, history programs for the BBC. So he's on TV a lot. And he's about 70 and appeared quite grumpy actually that morning. But my husband said, come on, go and tell him all you've uncovered. So I went up to him at JFK at 6:30. He was having a coffee in one of those places where you get a coffee and a bagel just before you get on the plane. And I said, hello, Mr. Sharma, you don't know me, but I'm uncovering all these stories. And he said something to me that day, and then he said it again by email. He said, it's really important that you tell your story, because in the end, that's what we are. We're all stories. So I think then it became a book. And Simon Sharma was very kind, and then he wasn't so kind. So he gave me his email, and he said, I'll help you. Send me a little bit of what you have. And then I sent him, as you can tell by the way I speak and the way I write, I'm not a good editor. So I probably sent him like 15 pages. And I think he might have opened it and gone, oh God, this is too long and I don't have the time. So he, having replied to my first email, having given me his email at the airport, he then replied to my first email. And then he didn't reply for about 2 years. And then he heard about my book and he did reply. But I had put everything together into these 10 pages of what my book was about. And I went to a dinner in New York, and I sort of crashed this dinner. So my aunt, who had worked in the United Nations, lives in New York City, and this was just after, so this was about 3 months after I had met Sharma, and he hadn't got back to me. And I wanted to figure out what the best medium was, hopefully to tell my story, but I have lots of friends who are writers, and I'm very aware that it's very difficult to get an agent, to get a book published, to get anyone to read it. So I wasn't super hopeful, but it was January the 3rd, and I think actually it was a very cold day, I remember that, and we were freezing, and we were in the Upper East Side in New York City, and we had just ordered Chinese food from a really revolting place called Pig Heaven. And my family and I were just stuffed, and it was just, you know, sort of, I don't know, 8:30, 9 o'clock at night. And we were sitting there, and my aunt sent me, called me and said, listen, I'm here with these people and I'm telling them your story. And by then my entire family had heard, my entire mother's family, I suppose, had heard all of my, about my research and my father's story. So everybody just knew the bones of it. And my aunt said, you have to come and tell these people, they remember you from when you were a little girl. And these people were a man and a woman in their late 80s, who had been ambassadors from the US to Venezuela, so they knew my dad. And she said, come and join us for a coffee. We're at a restaurant around the corner, at an Italian restaurant around the corner from your house. Come and join us for a coffee. And I said, no. I sort of went, you know what? I'm stuffed, I'm in pajamas, I'm cold, I'm with my kids. I'm not gonna go and crash this dinner party. And I'm always telling my children that they have to seize every moment. So they came up to me and said, right, how can you tell us this and then just sit here after all this work you've been doing and not go to this dinner? How do you know that this is not the dinner? And I said, well, you know, they're in their 90s and I'm just going to go and have a coffee with them and what's going to happen? And they basically just pushed me out the door. So I went off and went to this little Italian restaurant and met these people and told them the story. And then this man, he's called Bill. Bill sent me an email the next morning at about 6:30 in the morning. So I woke up at about 7. I already had an email from him saying, you really, really have to make this into a book. And our neighbor in Connecticut is someone I'm going to put you in touch with. So that started the ball rolling. The neighbor in Connecticut was a scout, so nothing to do with books, really, more to do with film. But she knew, she said, I have a friend who's an agent in London and who has a similar story to your father's. Her father left, was Jewish and left in 1938, and was the only one of his family that survived the war. Her mother was, one of the children that came over to England in the kinder transports. I'm sure you know about those. And she, like me, had grown up, her father had changed her name, and she, like me, had grown up not knowing anything about her inheritance. And she also happens to be one of the best agents in England, or actually, I think in the world, probably. So she sold my story, and that's why I'm here telling you all about my story. So I don't know if you want to ask questions. I don't know if you want me to tell you about my more bits about the journey, but I just thought I should start off by telling you this wasn't meant to be a book. And I'm thrilled it is, for so many reasons, because I feel it gives my grandparents a little bit of a voice and a tiny little bit more life. Not the life they should have had, but a tiny little bit of life. So I'm couldn't be happier. But Alice, I'll leave it with you maybe to ask questions or whatever.
Thank you so much.
I'm seeing questions, so I don't know if you do you want to read them and
well, hang on 1 second. What I'd like to do is, if I may, is just sort of jump in, pull something. You've said so much, and what a privilege and what an honor to be able to sit here with you today. And what's so remarkable in terms of this idea of sharing our stories is that clearly this is a story. This is your story. It's your father's story. It's Czechoslovakia's part of their story. And as Jewish people, it's our story as well. And so when you pulled out the box, the card, I almost cried, because the immediacy, like there it is. You're holding it in your hand. Here you are. This is it's a legacy for so many people, and absolutely, it's a legacy this story and everything that you've uncovered is a legacy of the Jewish people. And so it's just incredible that you've carried this story forward. And yet I think it's like you said, the friends that helped that were not Jewish. It was, you know, it's so many people's stories. And yet it all starts with you as a child, your curiosity. I was interested in your process as well about how did this, you know, shape your identity? And, you know, were you always curious? But you did say it in, you know, you opened up with, you knew your father had suffered trauma, even as a child. And of course, children sort of know when their parents, when something's wrong, they know, and you say this in the book, what to address and what not to. But this gift that you've brought to us, and I'm going to jump around a little, and I definitely want to scroll through the questions. I think that the form, the what I found so compelling about this particular book is that you've taken us through this journey, and with every description of every person, of every place, wherever you had an opportunity to bring a picture, like whatever it was that gave you the context, you placed it there. So I felt that this was like reading a very intimate family memoir, not just the story of the tragedy and the trauma and the adversity, which absolutely is at the center of this, but I don't know if others felt this, but you brought us into your family, and I felt like I knew your grandfather and your grandmother and most certainly your father, and just the beauty of who they were as just at their very basic human level, who they were, mm-hmm. you know, before this, during this. And then of course, there's how this event comes to shape them and what they're left with. So I thought that was so beautiful that there was all this beautiful evidence and all this, you know, you read a book and you want to know more about them and their, you know, the letters and their words. And that was particularly just beautiful. I have a question in terms of, so here you are and you discover the cracks when you're a child, and yet there's something in you that knows not to open this up, so to speak, even when you're bringing up a family, because you know that something big is under there. But I'm curious as to, as an adult, to be able to open this up and then discover this when you've had X amount of years being Ariana Neumann, right, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, or maybe that's not your married name, but you know who you are, you have a sense of where you grew up. Yes, you know, it was interesting to hear about and important to hear about you studying philosophies, Judaism, different religions, because that piece was not a part of your growing up, because you didn't know it until college. I mean, I'm interested in what is that like for you to suddenly, as an adult, when you think you know XYZ, to discover there's a whole other dimension to who you are, to your identity. And of course, you know, you're looking back at your father, and yet there's your children in front of you, because this is, you know, this is who you all are. So I don't know if that's probably a very long question, but what was that like for you to suddenly, new identity, here you are, Jewish, and we think of sometimes, and then I promise I'll shut up, you know, their story, it's the story of the Jews, or it's the story of the Europeans, and suddenly, here you are, it's your story. Not just that, all of this. I mean, I don't know where you've placed it yet and organized it inside of you. So
it is a long question. I'm going to try to sort of condense the answer so that it makes sense, and I can, and it might just be that I end up answering little bits. But I think a lot of it, so how it's changed me, it's and my identity. So I have to start by telling you that because I never felt like I belonged anywhere fully, and that had maybe to do with the fact that I grew up in Venezuela, and Venezuela is no longer the place I grew up in at all. And most of my family have gone, and I've, you know, I'm sort of a refugee in London. Obviously, it's a different kind of refugee than my father was. But I even before that, I never felt I really belonged anywhere. So I always felt that. I mean, I can't tell you that I knew that I was Jewish because I couldn't have phrased it that way, but I've always felt that there was something, you know, I always felt a little bit like an imposter. And I did very much, when I was in Catholic school, feel very much like an imposter. So discovering this doesn't seem the huge surprise that you would think it would be. It just, all of a sudden, it's like the puzzle all fits together, and now I understand why I felt that way. So I don't know if that answers your question. And I think identity is a fluid thing. So I think, you know, I think we're constantly recreating our identity. I think we've taught, you know, because identity is not just made, it's made up of who you think you are and who others think you are, and the ties that, you know, the things that bind you to communities and to works and to jobs and to, you know, so that's probably changed quite a lot. And, you know, I feel wrongly or rightly quite at home. I feel quite Jewish, even though I'm not a religious person. So I wasn't, aside from a very brief moment when I was 9, when I was so desperate to fit in that I wanted to be a nun. Which lasted about 2 seconds. And I think my mother, as punishment, then sent me to the most Catholic, most conservative place that she could think of. And that really cured me of anything and made me realize that I really just had absolutely nothing in common with these people. So I feel quite at home. I have friends of all religions, but I love the traditions that Jewish people have. So I love Shabbat dinners. And we don't call them Shabbat dinners at home because, again, we're not religious, but we've always been having them. It turns out we just call them Pizza Fridays. And I don't mean any disrespect when I say this, but we've always, you know, family is the most important thing in my life and always has been. And it's not just the family that came before me. It's also my children. And we've always made a point, and Friday nights have been absolutely sacred. We all meet around the table. We sometimes bring friends, but none of my children ever miss Friday night. And we always make a point of being particularly kind and nice and listening to one another. And I think the Shiva, I mean, I had a very close friend who was Orthodox, who died last year of a brain tumor. And I was lucky enough to witness a Shiva, and it was, I think it's the most beautiful way of mourning that I have ever seen. And to me, the conception of God that is a Jewish God, a God that is not necessarily all good, is much more, I can live with that. I can't really live with a Christian God, if that makes any sense, because to me, it's a Christian all good God, what, that just favors some people and not others and has and allows horrendous suffering. It's not conceivable to me. So I guess what I'm trying to tell you is I felt I was always looking for this, and I feel like I found it. In terms of identity and what it's done to me and how it's changed me, I would tell you that it's a little bit like parenthood. So you know when you have a kid and someone says, have you been changed? How have you been changed by parenthood? And actually, they should really ask you 20 years later. Because if they ask you and your baby's just been born, and you look at this little bundle of sort of, you know, pinkness that cries and poos, and you have diapers, and you have sort of sleepless nights, and you have all these sort of, you just don't quite know how it's changing. You feel it's changed you, right? And you know it from day one, but you don't quite comprehend the way it's seismically altered your life until decades later. And so I guess this is the reverse of that, right? It's finding these grandparents that I didn't know I had. So I'm discovering these members of my family that, you know, it's not like being a mother, but it's all of a sudden I'm a granddaughter, and I'm a granddaughter of these people who were absolutely beautiful and brilliant and brave, and whose lives were cut very short, and who I actually am incredibly lucky to not only be related to, but I'm also incredibly lucky that I've somehow, I guess, because they died in such a terrible way, their letters were kept. And those letters have given me a window to who they were that I probably wouldn't have had. So because I came quite late in my father's life, I would have, my grandfather would have been 80 when I was born. So I probably wouldn't have gotten to know him. And I
question. Can I jump in? And so just on that, in discovering these your grandparents, uncles, different members of the family, who is there anybody that you see yourself in? That's where I get that trait. That's what that's about.
I do. I'm really pedantic and detail-oriented. So I'm a little bit like my grandfather, and that's not at all who I want to be like. I want to be like my grandmother. But I'd like, because she's just so joyful and she lives in the moment. So I would tell you that I have a lot of traits of my grandfather, but I try very actively to be more like my grandmother, because I think she is, you know, especially actually now that we're in the pandemic, I just think, okay, so how would she have seen it? And she would have made the absolute most of every moment. And she would have found joy in the little things. And you know, I think there's all these things that I look at how she lived in the camp, and I read her letters, and she is, it's just remarkable, because she's ill actually towards the end of her life. She has her gallbladder, she has an infection, and she and yet she manages to maintain meaning throughout. She manages to keep that hope of seeing her golden boys, and you know, and to do everything for that. But at the same time, you know, she's joyful, and she manages to sort of focus on the beauty of things. Whereas even my grandfather does a little bit of that. So there's one great scene. I mean, I think it's a great scene. It's not, you know, and this is how someone asked me the other day, how could you cope with writing about this? And I guess I sometimes, the writing was more difficult. When I do the research, I distance myself from it. So I sometimes say there's a great scene, or, you know, there's a great mystery. And it's because I guess sometimes to cope with it, I it's not that I ever forget I'm their granddaughter or the daughter, but I become the detective or the writer.
You have to, sure, emotionally distance yourself from the, or become the witness, because to, you know, the magnitude of what they went through. I mean, I don't have to tell you. So of course it makes total sense that you would have to sort of, you know, become like the journalist or the detective.
Exactly, and CSP.
Which leads me to something that I found interesting in this process of learning about your father, most especially, is that when we look at a parent, we look at a grandparent, these are our protectors. And in a good sense, they're the authority figures for children. They're the people we look up to. So to begin to see, I wonder what it was like for you to begin to understand your father from a very different lens, to see his vulnerability. I mean, most certainly he was courageous, he was intelligent, he was brave, but to see even your grandfather had, I mean, your grandmother was wonderful. You know, she had that spirit, I see it. But there was something very, like a container, like that the men in the family, you know, your grandfather held by his principles. And so to see them in this new life, but especially to see a parent and to know that your own parent went through something like that and was helpless at times and that sort of thing. I wonder what that experience was like for you as a daughter.
You know, it was quite upsetting, and I think I talk about it at the end of the book. So I have to tell you, the other thing that I fought with my agent about this is I never wanted to put myself in the book. So I felt very strongly that the remarkable, and I still do, that the important stories there are my family stories and not mine. But my agent said she wouldn't represent me if I didn't put myself and a little bit of my journey in it. And that was difficult. Because one, I was going through that journey as I was writing it. So it was, again, a little bit like asking me to sort of, you know, how do you feel, you know, when I was still processing it all. But there was a moment, and I do talk about it in the book, and it wasn't actually in the first draft of the book, which is when I discover that voice, it's towards the end, and I say I have terrible nightmares, when I discover the link really between my father, the father I met, and that young boy in Prague. And it's that last letter, or the only letter that I have of my father's, from June 1945, where he says, I work and work and work, and that's the only thing I can do so that I don't think about how many of us didn't come back. And that was very, very difficult. And I couldn't sleep, I couldn't write, I had terrible nightmares. And actually, I hadn't had one of them until the other day, and I still get it, and I still wake up just going, oh, I have to, you know, there's something pressing, I have to talk to that man, and I still, so it was very difficult. I'm just completely, sorry, I've lost my train of thought there, but that was, I mean, I think that journey of realizing that our parents are not these sort of two-dimensional heroes that we deem them to be when we're growing up, mm-hmm. is actually common to everyone, regardless of whether you have a father that lived through the Holocaust or lived whatever. I think as parents, I mean, I certainly do this with my own children. I show them a side to me, which is a little bit more together than I tend to be. It's possibly a little less angry than I tend to be. Not always, because I do have teenagers, so I get really angry sometimes. But, you know, I portray myself as just stronger than I am, and having less doubts, and you know, having more certainty about life. And I think all parents do this. And as children, we look at them and we think, okay, so these are authority figures, and they know more than us. And at some stage in our lives, we tend to realize that that's not true. And we tend actually to see parents as a little bit more three-dimensional, and to realize actually that they're not just our parents. They were also, you know, pretty interesting or pretty cool or pretty boring people, but they were people before they had us. And often they don't share those, you know, most, you come into your parents' life usually when they're about, I don't know, 25 or 30. Those 25 years before, you usually don't ask too many questions about. In my case, I had 50 years, so I had a lot more. But it's, I think we all come to a point where we realize our parents are not just parents, but they're humans, and that if, and people with fears and joys and whatever else makes them who they are. And we start sometimes asking questions. Sometimes it comes too late, because sometimes we realize that when we realize that they're vulnerable and they're frail and they're old. In my case, I you know, I didn't ask enough questions. I wish I could have asked more.
Back to what we have in terms of the book and what you do know. Tell us, what is one of your most memorable scenes in the book, or, you know, give us some of your, I mean, it's hard to use the word favorite in this context, but what are the things that really are, that are standouts for you in scenes in this book?
So there's lots. I think there's one exciting one, and I'll start with that one, just because there's two exciting ones, but there's one where which is my father and Zdenek, and they're hiding in the Montana paint factory, and my father's been hiding for, I think by then, about 6 weeks, and him and Stenek decide, well, more him than Stenek, but they decide that he's going to cross into Berlin. And there's that moment, and actually the book in Czech is called The Shadow Beneath the Candle, because it's a very famous saying in Czech. And I think that moment of where he sort of says, okay, I'm going to do the craziest thing imaginable, is really, really wonderful. I think in terms of happy moments, I think Stenka's sneaking into the camp is just remarkable. And I actually think, I think you're right about the men being very principled, but I think what is remarkable to me is about how brave and the love of women in the book. So not only my grandmother, who does whatever she can to help everybody, including possibly having an affair with someone in the camp, which is obviously pretty controversial thing to do, but I generally think she did it out of a desire to keep alive. But I think Stenka sneaking into Theresienstadt is a really wonderful moment. And what was wonderful to me was to have not only Stenka's memoirs that she had written, but to have corroboration in my grandmother's letters, and to see the joy that it, obviously that visit from Stenka, which was completely insane. So she wasn't the only person to sneak into in a concentration camp, but she was one of a handful. I mean, it's not something that you could do easily, and she did it twice. Mm-hmm. I always wear when I need a little bit of luck, I wear these things, and you know, that's the ring that my grandfather made for Stenka. So I don't know if you can see it. You can sort of see it in the book, but it's just, you know, it's pretty ugly, I have to confess, if you don't know the story behind it. But you sort of realize that she was so brave and brought so much love and joy to my grandparents that, you know, my grandfather had to get whatever it is that he could, and it happened to be a copper pipe, and just, you know, with a hammer and a nail, just put her initials there. So those are the sort of brave moments. In terms of sad moments, I think the 449, the sort of that, the and again, that's the other thing I can show you here. So just so you get a sense of how lucky I am to have these things, because this is a transport ticket, and I'm gonna pull it out, and I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but it's incredibly thin, right? And I don't have huge hands, it's pretty small, and it's super, I mean, it's literally just a little wisp of paper. And that was my father's transport ticket from when his father, who was 448, was transported. So the fact that this little wisp of paper, forgive me, I'm gonna just put it back in, I don't like having it out of the thing because it's so delicate, survived is pretty, I mean, it's just astounding, right? I mean,
it's remarkable.
It went from Prague to Venezuela to here, and it's, I mean, it's just so thin and minute. And the fact that my father kept that, to me, is symbolic of how important that moment was. So I think that moment where he said goodbye to his father, where he was wrenched from him, without even being able to say goodbye to his father, which is, of course, that moment when he is at the fence, when we go together in 1990 to Prague, and he's at the fence, and the fence is swaying with the force of his sobs. You know, I think finding that made me understand that moment better. And I cannot even imagine what it must have been like to say goodbye, or not say goodbye, but to know that your father was leaving and being deported to this place where your mother was saying, do whatever you can, but don't come here. So I think that's a terrible moment. And then, of course, when the shoe polish washes off his hair is heartbreaking, because he, you know, and I kept it when I was doing my research, sorry, when I was doing my research, I kept on thinking, if he had only lived a few more months, it was just literally just a matter of a few more months, and, you know, or if the Allies had come in. But I mean, you know, by the time he was deported, I mean, D-Day landings had already happened, and you just think, you know, anyways. I think that moment is memorable, I guess. And my grandmother walking into the train station on her own, carrying her own bags. Anyways, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Let's go to the chat because we have so many really good questions. I'm going to scroll back up.
A really interesting question there.
Yes.
Sorry, but you go.
Okay, I see. What do you think your father would think about this book?
You know, I hope he would have liked it. I think I did something, and not very many people noticed it because it was a book filled with detail. But I try to make it like a watch. So, and actually, the New York Times book reviewer picked this up, and I was so grateful, one, to be reviewed in the New York Times, but two, that she picked it up, because it's made of slightly different stories. So to me, it's a little bit like the wheels in a mechanism of a watch. And I talk a lot about watches because they're metaphors and because actually I'm paying homage to my father who loved watches. So I try to make it, it's a book obviously, and I've always loved books, but he always loved watches. So I would hope that he would like it. I hope he would feel I did justice to his parents and to his story. So I think he would like it. I think he would chuckle a lot of this, and he'd be really thrilled. He'd go, "Look, you made it into the New York Times bestseller list." He'd be, you know, he had a great sense of humor, and he never thought stuff like that was important at the same time. But he would have been proud, I hope.
Well, I think, first of all, I think there's that pivotal scene. I mean, there's the title of the book, When Time Stopped. There's the pivotal scene where he tells you, I think it's on page 189, he says to you, maybe I'll read it even. You know, this whole idea of time, which also we were speaking the other day in terms of even now in the present moment with the pandemic, and suddenly we all had to shelter, and time just became, this elusive thing, right? Monday was Tuesday was when, like, there was no demarcation between the days. And so it's page 189. And I'm not sure if you were a young child, but you're watching him with the watches. You know what I'm talking about? Do you... the second to last paragraph. Do you want to read it or should I read it?
No, I'm very happy to read it. The one
about where he starts with, he explained to me that he had become enthralled by watch mechanisms and props.
Sure, I'm happy to read it. I love that part. I love this part, so I'm very happy to read it. He explained to me that he had become enthralled by watch mechanisms in Prague when he was a young man. He said that it was during a period when he had so much time on his hands, he felt that time had stopped. How could time have stopped? Because, he said, and you will understand this when you're older, sometimes you just feel that everything around you has come to an end. You feel that you're completely alone, that time is frozen, and that you are invisible. At first, you might feel exhilarated by the sense of freedom, but then you'll be frightened that you are lost and that you will never be able to go back. He explained that when he first felt this, he had been isolated and afraid and had pried open his watch case to verify that time was indeed passing. The rhythm of the watch might have been imagined. Sound was not enough. He needed to see it and touch it. It was the first time that he had dismantled a mechanism. The turning wheels, ticking each second away, had reassured him. It was then that he had comprehended the importance of time. Do you want me to go on?
Can we stop right there?
Mm-hmm.
So, it's so beautiful, and you read it so beautifully.
Thank you.
So this idea, I mean, do you feel that, you know, this story, when time actually stops, right? This idea that your father's feared that he would cease to exist, and yet you bring in this book and you bring this part of life, you bring it to life, I should say. So do you feel that you were able to, like, you give that, you know, there's this whole idea of your father's identity and, you know, who he is, and you know, he's Hans, he's Jan, you know, but this fear of his that he will be, you know, everything will stop. Do you mm-hmm. feel that you were able to succeed in giving life to this time where everything seems to have seized in a certain way?
You know, it's what I try to do. And I think we all are a bit critical of what we do. And I don't know if we ever fully succeed at anything, but when I actually do events like this and I connect to all of you, then I sort of feel like maybe I did succeed a tiny little bit because there's people reading it and you guys are here listening. So yes.
Well, I think you did a wonderful job. Let's go back to, do you want to pick a question from the chat?
Well, actually there was, I'm sort of going.
Why don't you pick a question?
So do you consider sharing the box with the Holocaust Museum? Yes, I am absolutely going to share the box with the Holocaust Museum. It's my box and I mean, that's my box for sure, but my grandparents' letters also belong to my cousins and we want to keep it all together. So I think what we're probably going to do is we're going to give it to the Jewish Museum in Prague simply because that seems the right place for it to go to, really. I think there's better Holocaust museums in the US for sure and in Israel. But my grandparents, for a little while at least, felt very Czech. And they, I don't know if you know a lot about this, but it wasn't until the 19th century that Jews in Central Europe were given a nationality. And they felt very, very proud and they felt very Czech. And they even, you know, many of them, including my grandfather, fought for the Kaiser in the Austro-Hungarian Empire in World War I. So they felt very Czech. And they, because they felt so Czech, they felt that nothing could ever happen to them. Which brings me to another question from Rina Braha. Was there no anti-Semitism before Hitler invaded? Was it common for Jews and non-Jews to mix and marry? I think this is really interesting. So I think that there's terrible anti-Semitism everywhere all the time, now and then. And, you know, if you go back to the 13th century, during the plagues, Jews were blamed. I think people like to blame the other, and if you, the other was often Jews. And so I think it was there. What is interesting is that in cities, and this is mostly in Vienna, in Berlin, most German cities, but certainly in Vienna and Prague, Jews in the 19th century, and there's a great play by Tom Stoppard, which is going to come over to New York, called Leopoldstadt, which addresses this a little bit. He's just put it on in London. It had to close down, obviously, because of the pandemic, but it's really beautiful. And a lot of the Jews, because they had been given citizenship in all these countries, felt very comfortable and assimilated. And I don't think they completely gave up their roots, but a lot of them intermarried. So about 30% of Czech Jews and German Jews and Austrian Jews were married to non-Jews. So it was actually very common in the 20th century and for this to happen, certainly in urban centers in Europe, less so in Russia and less so in the Baltic states. But they were less accepted as well. So there was probably more anti-Semitism in those countries. And actually, if you look at the Holocaust and the Holocaust in the Baltic states, so in Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania, there were very few Jews, and they were absolutely decimated. So it was really just awful, the anti-Semitism there. How did I reconcile the father that was and the father you had? So, you know, I think we all are many different people during our lives, and yet we all remain the same. And I think finding traits of my father that were constant made me reconcile that. I think looking back, and getting glimpses of what he went through, and especially in Berlin, explained to me why he was the way he was, if that makes sense. And if there was anything to forgive, and and he never did anything terrible that I needed to forgive him for, but he was sometimes probably a little more distant or less emotionally engaged, I guess, than most other fathers that I see around. I now know why. How have my findings affected my children? It's interesting. I didn't think they had been horribly affected. It's been the last 10 years has been very gradual. Just to give you an idea, my oldest is 18, my youngest is 15. So I have an 18, a 16, and a 15-year-old. So really, since they were 8, 6, and 5, they've been navigating this with me and discovering different things. I didn't know how much of their identity was tied to it. And then my son, who just applied to college, and if with a little bit of luck, he's going to UChicago in September, wrote his essay. And his essay was about his journey through my journey. Mm-hmm. So it's obviously affected him more.
Can I say something right there?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Because you had said a couple of minutes back that you did not want to place yourself in this book. And I think a lot of, there's such a strength in the fact that you are in this book, because here you are in the present moment and you're going through your father's past, the history. And it's so important for us to remember, and there's a really, and I don't want to forget actually as I say this, there's the part of what your children say in terms of how they're affected or not affected and whether things get handed down generationally, which is a very interesting part. But this idea of we're not just isolated in time right now, this is who we are, this is the present moment, but we need to be having a voice with our past or the family's past or our legacy and that sort of thing. So I think that your understanding, at least my experience in reading the book, it seemed like your understanding was like opening up every, you know, with each step, with each letter, with each, as you walk this path. And it felt like this is really important. Because these are important stories and we need to be able to share them and just know that they are a part of history. Like we say, don't, you know, never forget. So this idea of the past and the present moving together. And also what's interesting is that in today's day and age, we're all telling our stories. We're all very open. Yes. You know, your father, I'm sure, I don't want to speak to that, but there's a trauma, so he couldn't speak about it. But in those day and age, people didn't talk about their experiences, their issues. Now it's such a different world that our children and you know, grandchildren are growing up in today, because we, you know, it's all out there. So it's really, I think there's an importance to that.
It's true. Actually, there was a question from Irene Hannan, which I think ties into that, which is, children of survivors often have inherited trauma. Do you think this is why your father kept the story from you? And I think you're absolutely right, Alice, that it has to do with a generational thing. And I think it's a generational thing. I think people didn't open up because they didn't believe in the power of, it's not that they didn't believe in telling stories, but there was a certain sort of, I don't know what it was, but you didn't want to be self-absorbed and you didn't want to bring your own sorrows into the present. So I think, you know, I think it would have been difficult for my father in 1970 to all of a sudden open up to his 9-year-old and start telling me about, you know, about his trauma in Berlin, which had happened so long before. I think he would have felt it would have been a self-centered imposition on me. And at the same time, as you say, there wasn't this belief in opening up as a therapeutic device. Mm-hmm. I've talked to a lot of people who are Holocaust survivors, and they tend to go two ways. And I, my father might just strike me down from wherever he is and say, I like to think that, and I, not that I'd like to think, but I often felt that if I, this had happened to me, I would have gone the other way. And I would have, in defiance of the Nazis, actually just chosen to be as Jewish as I can be and carry on the traditions and pass on that legacy. And my father chose not to do that. And I now realize that that is, well, because I think if you've lived through that, you either choose the path that I just mentioned, or you choose to say, you know what, my family were all killed because they were labeled for being Jews. So I'm not going to label myself or my children with anything at all, because that's going to do them more harm than good. So you then forego all the inheritance and all the weight of the past and all the weight of the beautiful traditions for a sense of freedom and a sense that you're unburdening your child, and that those that come come after you, and you're just, you know, and I think he felt, my father felt, that somehow that would have been a horrendous weight for me to carry, not just the trauma, but the identity. And he just put it aside, and he was in a new continent in a country where no one was asking too many questions. So he could do that. So I think that's why he didn't pass it on. And essentially, because someone said, I joined this second generation group in England, and it was a bit like a sort of therapy session. And I realized that even the people that whose parents didn't talk about their experiences still had a little bit of trauma. So I was, and this is again very recent, so I can't talk to you with great authority about this, but I was trying to figure out if I was traumatized and if I would have been more traumatized if my father shared these stories with me. And the answer, of course, is I don't know. I definitely sensed, and you know, I think you pass on trauma even when you don't speak about it. Mm-hmm. And I think there is something cathartic and wonderful about speaking about it, and I miss that out. Having said that, my cousins, whose father, Lothar, spoke a little bit more about it, would probably disagree with me. So there you go. I don't know if that answers anyone's question or if I'm just rabbiting on.
So are there other questions? I have one last question. Are we towards the end, guys? Should we keep going? Julie and Monique and Ariana?
whatever you want. I'm here. I'm husband's taking care of dinner, so it's all right.
Okay. So this book, it sounds like it started out as a quest to understand who you were, right? You said that you never felt like you belonged, and then it became the story of your father and his family. And now this book is out there. It's out there for everybody to be able to either learn something from or experience. What would you want people to gain from reading this, your book? I mean, we're in a time where there's so much, not to be political, but we're in a time where there's so much divisiveness, and this book is so much about humanity. I mean, even just the beauty and the simplicity of your parent, your grandparents in the country house, and it's about humanity, you know, the range and what we experience. So I just sort of wonder what impact would you want it to be on people?
You know, I want them to take a whole bunch of things from it, but I really, it all boils down to the same thing. I want them to take away really what is important, and what is important remains the same, regardless of whether you're in a pandemic or you're in a war or you are in normal times, if you can call the 1936 in Czechoslovakia normal time. What remains important, I think, is finding what binds you, and what binds you to others, what binds you to your family, but what binds you to the other, and to not label people, and to try to just find things that you have in common. And at the same time, the flip side of that is to realize how insidious anti-Semitism and racism is, how we adopted, you know, without even meaning to, all the time. We make assumptions about people that are different than us. And how something like the Holocaust didn't just happen overnight. So it wasn't like Hitler arrived in 1939, dispatched everybody to the camps, and then eventually to the gas chambers. It was absolutely insidious, and it happened in minute little laws. And I think I tried to do that. There's a chapter where I talk about all the laws, and I tried to make them a bit like the TikToks of every watch. And there were about 600 laws passed over years. And that's what bullies do. That's what governments that seize power do, is they don't just from one day to the other, you know, do something horrific. They do it in tiny little things. So they destroy the language that we use. And I think it's important to realize that. And I think it's important to realize how governments and presidents and prime ministers, depending on what country you're in, do this. But they seize the language and they destroy the language and the morals. And they it's just really insidious. And they pass little laws. So if someone, one of my editors actually said to me, I don't understand why they didn't rebel. When I was telling them the story before I told them the book. And I said, but because what are you going to rebel against? Are you going to rebel against the fact that you have to turn in your radio or your typewriter? Or is it when they push you and say you can no longer have pets? You know, the laws are so minimal, but yet they're there. And so I think you have to combat anti-Semitism and indeed racism at the very basic level. And you have to find what binds you, and you have to realize that what is important is doing the right thing. And I think too many of us just don't do the right thing and don't stand up for what we know is the right thing out of comfort, out of fear, out of, you know, all sorts of things. So I hope that's what they take away. And I hope they take away that no matter where you are, whether it's in a camp or whether it's in, you know, my delving in this darkness, there's always beauty and there's always joy. It doesn't matter if you're in a pandemic, there's always wonderful things. And if you focus on those and you maintain meaning and you maintain hope and you let go of control a little bit, that need that we all have to control everything, then you find beauty and you can spend pretty much everything. So I don't know.
Ariana, this was a fascinating discussion. You've given us all so much to think about as well. A lot of what you said is lingering in my mind, and I know I'm going to mull over it for a long time to come. But really, I think everybody enjoyed this so much and enjoyed the book so much. Thank you for bringing it to light. Thank you for joining us today. Alice, I don't see, oh, there you are. Okay. Thank you as well. And Monique, and like I said, this was the Center Culture Club. Follow me on Instagram so you know about our next book club and everything else coming up. And also SCA, thank you for joining us. So anybody have anything else to say, please, you can chime in now or put it in the chat.
Oh, and someone actually asked me if it was going to be a movie, and I'm really lucky that I have a producer. Well, I've had a few producers interested, but I'm in talks with one of them, and she seems very nice and very thoughtful. So
good luck to you. That's fascinating. Wow. That's really something.
Thank you, Ariana. Beautiful.
Thanks very much. Thank you for having me, and have a lovely rest of your day and a good
week. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Any other questions or anything, please just email me. I'm here love chatting. So thank you very much. Thank you, Monique.
Somebody from Caracas.
Thank you, Julie.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
You. Bye. Thank you.